his sheep, and Jesus is our shepherd. And we can read in Psalm 23, and David wrote these words 1,000 years before Jesus ever spoke of being the good shepherd in John chapter 10. And I'm going to invite you, if you care to, you don't have to, but just to close your eyes and just, there's such a visual in Psalm 23 of just God caring for us, being our shepherd. And just allow these words to speak to you, and just to give you the image of Jesus being our shepherd and caring for us, and being if you think of a shepherd leading his sheep, he is always there to protect, to care, and to provide, and that is what Jesus does for us, and it is who we cling to today during a time like this. So I'm going to read Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Such a special promise that the scriptures give us there. And touching on verse 4 just a little bit there, talks about going through the valley of the shadow of death. And to get to the mountaintop, to get to the mountains, Dean, we know that he was an outdoorsman, and there's no doubt in my mind that he loved the mountains. I have been to the mountains, and it's a beautiful, special place to be. It can be a place of just feeling close to God, and to get to the mountaintop, you have to go through the valley. And David talks about going through the valley of the shadow of death. And he says, yet I will fear no evil. The danger is in the valley. And yet the promise is that God is with us, even in the valley. Going through a valley today with the loss of a loved one and laying Dean's body to rest. And just having that promise of God always being with us. So in my encouragement to all of us, to the family especially, is just to trust in God. Trust in God and his will, his perfect will. His will is perfect. And don't lose hope. Our hope is in him. He is Jesus Christ, death on the cross and his resurrection has given us a living hope, and let's cling to that hope that he gives us, and experience the peace that the Bible says that only God can give through knowing him. So again, just a welcome to all of you, and for the order of the service, we'll have a couple of congregational songs, two songs by Steve Yoder, and then Pastor Sam will be sharing a message. After that, we'll have tributes from the family, and then the obituary and the final viewing. So let's pause for a word of prayer, and Steve, if you want to prepare to lead us in a couple songs. Our Heavenly Father, we bow before you this afternoon, and we just recognize you as Almighty God. We recognize you that you are in control, and that you love and care for each one of us, and we don't always understand the things that happen, the things that we go through, but we know that we can put our trust and our hope in you, because you are in control, and you hold the future in your hands, and we just invite the power and the presence of your Holy Spirit here today to minister to our hearts peace and comfort, especially for the family as they lay the body of Dean to rest. May your power and your strength rest upon them. And for the days and weeks to come, as we go from here today, I just pray for your guidance and your protection and your blessing over each person here today. We commit the remainder of this service to you. Commit Pastor Sam to you. May your anointing rest upon him as he shares with us today. God, we thank you that we can call you our shepherd, that you care for us, provide for us, and that you protect us. And we give you honor and glory and praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's turn to number 800 in our faith and praise songbooks. Number 800.
What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful? Share. Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Are we weak and heavy laden, cumbered with a load of care? Gracious Savior, still our refuge, take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find a solace there.
Number 885. Number 885.
We read of a place that's called heaven. It's made for the pure and the free. These truth in God's word he has given. How beautiful heaven must be. How beautiful heaven must be. sweet home of the happy and free. Fair haven of rest for the weary. How beautiful heaven must be. In heaven no drooping nor pining, no wishing for elsewhere to be. God's light is forever there shining. How beautiful heaven must be. How beautiful heaven must be. Sweet home of the happy and free. Fair haven of rest for the weary. How beautiful heaven must be. Pure waters of life there are flowing, and all who will drink may be free. Rare jewels of splendor are glowing. How beautiful heaven must be. How beautiful heaven must be. Sweet home of the happy and free. Fair haven of rest for the weary. How beautiful heaven must be.
Grace and peace to everyone. I greet you in Christ's name this afternoon. Thank you for coming out and supporting the family during the loss of a loved one, a brother, a son, and an uncle to many nieces and nephews, and a close friend to many of you. We as a church appreciate that you are here to support the family. The loss of a loved one is never easy, no matter if it's a senior or older person that is on their deathbed or if it's sudden. It's a loss. And that's because we have relationships with each other, and that is good. And most of all, that we have a relationship with Jesus Christ. I'd like to just share a few verses in Psalm 91. Ray shared those with you as a family, but I just the first two verses there are worth repeating. It says, "He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress and my God. In Him will I trust." Anytime that I read those verses, I think of the picture of a mother hen and with her chicks hiding underneath her wings for protection. And to you as a family, and to us, to just hide under the shadow of our Father in heaven during this time for protection. And also in Psalm 121, it says, "I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help." It says, "My help cometh from the Lord who made heaven and earth." And where else can we as believers turn to during a time like this than to God and His Word? So I want to bless you with those words. And, you know, all of the songs that are sung today and the scriptures that are shared and the tears that are shed are part of the healing of losing a loved one. And as I was talking with Esther yesterday, and just the fact that this is her oldest son, her firstborn, and all of the children are special, but there's a bond there between your firstborn, and especially realizing that she lived longer there at home with Dean than she did with Dan, and there was a connection there. And one of the things that was just shared that this blessed my heart. One of the children said that Dean would come home and he would ask, "Mom, do you need to go anywhere? Is there anything you need?" Just a picture of Dean's heart of caring for Mom. So where do we turn to during a time like this? We turn to God's Word. I'd like to just read a few verses out of 2 Corinthians chapter 1, the words of Paul. He says, "Grace be," in verse 2, "grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comforts." Verse 4 says, "Who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God." A lot of comfort mentioned in there by Paul. So what is Paul saying there? Where do we go to for comfort during a time like this? We've mentioned we turn to friends, or friends and loved ones come, family members from far, to pay their last respects to our brother. And just a reminder that what we have before us is the body of Dean. His spirit has left his body, is no longer with us, but we still mourn and grieve because we're relational human beings. How else are we comforted? You know, the one place that we as believers can take comfort at knowing that death is not final. Death is the passageway to a better place. The death is the only way that we can move on to eternity, to heaven. The grave is not the final resting place for the believer. It's the passageway. Another way we can find comfort is that we will see our loved ones on the other side. That we know that we can see our loved ones in eternity. I'd like to read 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 17. This is talking about the resurrection and the second coming. It says, "Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord." And then he says, "Wherefore comfort one another with these words." So to us as believers today, we know by God's word that one day we can be reunited with loved ones in eternity. And eternity is forever. Our time here on this earth, we often think maybe 80 years on average, some longer. And for Dean, it was less. It was 62 years. And on our human minds, we think that was way too short. And it is a short time. 60 years is not a long time. But my encouragement to you as a family is to hold on to the memories that you have and not focus on what could have been, but focus on and cherish the memories that you had with our brother, with our uncle, with our friend. So where do we turn to in the future? I'd like to just read out of 1 Thessalonians some of the other verses there that talks about our future. It says, "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope." And the hope that we are talking about is a lively hope, a hope of knowing. "For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say that unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first." So that's the hope that we have. You know, the prayer and the desire today is that whether through life or death, that God is glorified, that God is magnified. And when we magnify something, we make it larger. And so we look at God's word and we take comfort in that. There'll be tributes shared later on, and those tributes are not to lift up man, but to reflect on his life and to share the experiences that you had with Brother Dean as a friend. It's not to lift him up, but to lift up Christ. So what does a Christian gain in dying? Because in Philippians 1, Paul says, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." And sometimes, have you ever pondered that verse? What is Paul saying? For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. What does he mean by that? What is Paul gaining? What has our brother Dean gained by death? It's hard in our human minds to imagine that and to grasp what it says. But when a believer dies, he gains freedom. And what's the freedom that we gain? The freedom from aches and pains. The freedom from, and us older ones can resonate with that easier than some of us younger ones, right? Freedom from aches and pains, from sorrow, from problems of this world, from suffering, from troubles. That's what a Christian gains when he passes on. He gains fellowship. Fellowship with other believers. We can read in the book of Revelation of gathering around the throne and singing, the elders, the 24 elders, and those who gave their lives, who were martyred, are forever before the throne praising God. And we gain knowledge. We will fully understand it. In 1 Corinthians it says that we look through a glass darkly. In other words, it's hard for us to see and to understand some of those things. But when death comes, we say, "Oh, now I understand. Now I see." And that's beautiful. So that is what we gain as believers. So for us who are still remaining here, some of us young, some of us older, have lived many years, the one thing that we all have to admit, that death is certain. At some point, unless Christ returns before, we will all face death. Hebrews 9:27 says, "It is appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment." That's in Hebrews 9:27. Revelation 20, verse 11 to verse 15 talks about, John says, has a picture of a scene in heaven there, and it's called the Last Judgment. And this is what he saw. He said, "This is what I saw. I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And it says the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works." And the beauty of verse 15 is so important. It says, "Whosoever's was not found written in the book of life." It says the goal is that all of our names are written in the book of life. Then it says, "Whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." That's one of the saddest verses if you stop and think about that. So my question to you that are all sitting here, is your name in the book of life? Is your name written in the book of life? You say, what do you mean by "is your name written in the book of life"? Acts chapter 16 is the story about Paul and Silas being in jail, and the jailer, because they were preaching, the jailer put him in the inner cell, put their feet in the stocks, and they were singing and praising God. And there was an earthquake, and all the doors opened, and all the chains were freed, and all the prisoners were free. And the jailer came running with a light, and he was ready to take his own life because he knew that he was in trouble if the prisoners would get away. And Paul said, "Don't worry, everybody's here." I'm paraphrasing here, I'm telling the story. And then he asked, "What must I do to be saved?" That's the question. We never found out what his name was, but he came to Paul and he said, "What do I have to do to be saved?" And he said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved." And that is my encouragement. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, and you've never made that commitment to Christ, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. And it's interesting how a man's life and his actions change when he becomes a follower of Christ, because before him and his family were saved that day or that evening, he was putting Paul and Silas in prison and putting their feet in the stocks. But after he became saved, it says that he invited Paul and Silas into his house and he washed them because they had beaten them, and they fed them. And that's a change that happens in a man's life when he becomes a believer. So how do we prepare for death? Acts chapter 4, verse 12, you know, it's not about the earthly things. It's not about, you know, on Tuesday morning, Dean didn't wake up and say, "Okay, I have to feed my deer for the last time." Because we have no promise. We don't know. In October, a month ago, his friend Leroy Yutzi called me the other night, and he said that they had spent 10 days together in Montana hunting for elk. And we talked, we had worked together, the three of us, and we're reminiscing. You know, when they planned that hunt, Dean wasn't saying, "Okay, this is the last time I'm going to Montana." In October, when we had communion here, and Aaron Miller just shared with me, he washed Dean's feet, and neither one of them were saying, "Okay, this is the last time that we're partaking of communion together. This is the last time I'm washing my brother's feet." Because we don't know. So we can't prepare for death in that way, but we can prepare our hearts spiritually, that we know that if Christ were returning today, or he would call us home, that we're ready. Acts 4:12 says, "Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under God given among men whereby we must be saved." There's only one way. Ephesians 4:8-9, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, and not of works, lest any man should boast." So our works is not what saves us. What Dean was a very kind man, not a man of a lot of words, but underneath that shell that some of us observed was a very soft, kind-hearted man who loved children and cared for people and had a heart for people. But that's not what saved him. That's not saving grace. It's only by accepting Christ as our Savior that saves us. 1 John 1:9, one of my favorite verses, says, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." In fact, there's a couple verses before that. Verse 7 says, "If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood," here's the key, "the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin." It's not our works, but our works and our actions and our words change when we become a believer. You know, as I was visiting with family and friends, and I was blessed by some of the stories that were shared. And Sammy, you shared a story that really blessed my heart. And you shared how Dean could fall asleep anywhere, draped over anything. He could just fall asleep. And you asked him one day, "Dean, how can you do that?" That's blessed my heart. His response was, "Because I have a clear conscience." So my challenge to you today is, can you fall asleep with a clear conscience? I also talked with a family member. We were just reminiscing, and we were talking about how important relationships are. And being able to have relationships with family. And he shared how him and his brothers, when there's a birthday, they go out to eat the month where the birthday is. And he said, I also have a neighbor who hasn't talked to his brother, who is his neighbor, for 20 years. He says he doesn't go out and mow lawn if his neighbor's out mowing lawn. How sad. A broken relationship. So my challenge to all of you is, again, can you fall asleep with a clear conscience? And how is your relationship with family members and with loved ones? Now, eternity is forever. Our time here on this earth, even though in our human minds we don't always act like it, we act like sometimes and we plan sometimes like we're going to be here forever, but it's short. So for ourselves who are still here, the song says that we are to live one day at a time. That's my encouragement to you as a family, Esther to you, to take one day at a time. God has a way of sustaining us. When we look at many years, it overwhelms us. But if we look at one day at a time, God gives grace for one day at a time. And also realizing, my heart just goes out to you as a family, having a sister and a daughter passing away earlier this year. And David, for you, losing a father, it's a lot of tears, a lot of grief. It's just my encouragement to you that are here to pray for the family. You know, we can look at the roads that weren't taken, the plans that were made that are not going to happen. We can choose to focus on that, or like I said, shared earlier, we can choose to focus on the memories that we have, the relationships that were built. Matthew 6, verse 34, it says, "Do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself." Do not be anxious for tomorrow. That's my encouragement to you as a family. 1 Peter 5, verse 7, is if you can just imagine this picture in your minds over the next weeks, and it says that we are to cast our burdens upon the Lord, for he cares for you. And the word comfort that I talked about earlier is that word in the Greek means to come alongside. And so if you can just imagine a father, I used to see your husband Dan or your dad. When I'd pick up Dean to go to work, I'd see him there at home. And I'm sure there were times for all of you that he took you children by the hand, took you out to the barn. That's the picture. That's what that word comfort is, to come alongside. And so along with that, when you as a family, your siblings, Esther, when you feel overwhelmed, just cast your burdens upon the Lord, because it says that he cares for you. To you as close friends, cast your burdens upon the Lord, for he cares for you. We can't carry that on our own. D.L. Moody said, "Earth is receding, heaven is coming down, and I am going home." Something that we have to look forward to as believers, that one day we can go home to be with our loved ones. Another verse that I'd just like to leave with you in Hebrews 13:5, it says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. His mercies are abundant there. I'd like to read in 1 Peter chapter 1. These are, a side column says, a believer's hope during the trials and joys. It says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is, now listen to the words, an inheritance that is incorruptible. I don't know how many of you have gone through the passing of mom and dad, and then there's the, what we typically call, you open the will and the inheritance is there. Those are all earthly things, and the sad thing about it is so many times it can just divide families, these earthly things that will one day burn up. It divides families to the point where sometimes they don't talk to each other for years, but not always. It can be a beautiful thing too. And my prayer is to you as a family to work together as you, there's a lot of things to go through as a family. I realize that with what Dean had. But my encouragement to you is to work together and to realize that all these things on this earth will one day burn up. He goes on to say, to an inheritance that is incorruptible, undefiled, and that fadeth not away. That's what we have to look forward to. Reserved in heaven for you. Verse 5, he says, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. So let's remember as we go from here, cherish the memories that were made with Dean. And let's not focus and become bitter about losing someone who, in our human minds, we think was way too soon. Yes, it was 62, as we look at that as a young age. And losing a loved one suddenly is very traumatic. And so my heart goes up out to you, especially the Wingard family, Marvin and Miriam. I just want to bless you and thank you for caring for Dean the last 4 hours of his life. I also just had to reflect, many of you knowing our brother Dean and spending a lot of time outdoors by himself, it was a blessing that he could be at his sister's house for the last evening of his life and they could be there caring for him. That was a blessing. And so I just, my condolence to you as a family, Esther, to you as a mother, losing your oldest son passing away. God bless you. Let's pray for the family during this time through the rest of this service and also in the coming weeks. Those are sometimes some of the hardest times. The fact that time moves on and people tend to forget. Let's not forget to pray for the family. Neighbors, you've been very gracious and supportive, and I want to bless you for doing that and being there. We're going to have a number of tributes here. We're going to start out with Josiah, son-in-law, and then following that, Dave Yoder, another brother-in-law, and then Karen, and then Sammy will finish with that. And I think there's one or two songs following that. So just before Josiah comes, I'll just share briefly. I had the privilege of starting to work at Alpine Structures probably when I was 18. And Dean came from home from Florida that spring, and we started at about the same time. And so I had Dean being Amish there. I picked him up for probably the first 12 to 15 years, and we rode to work together. And many memories of building storage barns and playing softball together. And good memories. And Esther, I remember a lot of mornings. I can remember him walking out of the house with a fresh egg sandwich in his hand that you made for him. And he would eat that on the way to work many a morning. So bless you for doing that. The other thing that I've found kind of comical is on the way home sometimes, I would, as we drove in the township road there, he would look around, he'd say, I'll say this in Dutch and then repeat it in English, and he would say, De mom had willen mij gaal, nu moet van die stad gaan. He would say, Mom took my horse to go somewhere again. That's okay. He probably went a little faster than Dad's, maybe. So, but God bless you, and just to you as a family, I just want to wish you God's blessing of comfort and peace during this time of loss. So, Desire, I'll turn the time over to you, and then the rest of you can follow with your tributes. And following that, then, we'll have the reading of the obituary.
When I think back at the memories I have of growing up at home with Dean, I think of my earliest memories of watching Dean clean his bicycle on weekends. It was always an in-depth cleaning. Every single spoke was cleaned. He also meticulously cleaned his guns. I can still remember the smell as I sat and watched. Another memory is the many baby deer we helped him bottle feed. Sometimes I helped him during the night feedings as well. He always took expert care of them. As I grew older, he took me along to church, youth functions, and occasional white-tailed deer auctions. I especially enjoyed these auctions, to just sit back and watch, listen, and see him interact with people. One thing I am very thankful for is that my oldest sons got to know Dean well. How they rejoiced when we drove in at Grandma's and saw that Dean was home. To them, this spelled four-wheeler rides, groundhog hunting, splitting and stacking firewood with Dean, and always after supper, some good storytelling. They were fascinated with his stories. Also, all the times we went to the Wednesday sale in Mount Hope and the pony sale with him. When I asked our sons if they had any memories to share, Logan said, he remembers how he took them on four-wheeler rides, how kind and gentle he was, and how he took care of them. Isaiah remembers how Dean taught him to walk quietly in the woods, how to tell where a deer was bedded down, and the different kinds of trees. Dean was a true outdoorsman. He loved everything about nature. Dean left a legacy of kind deeds, gentleness, and enjoying the beauty of nature God surrounded us with. He will be greatly missed, Sister Ann.
It was around 45 years ago that Dean and I became friends, and he took me down, introduced me to his family. I don't know what his ulterior motive was, but he introduced me to Rosanna, and we became good friends and eventually got married. Later on in life, I told Dean, "Thank you for doing that." You know, and then we grew up, we did a lot of playing softball and hunting and fishing together. And there's something about, you know, when I told him thank you, and those of you that played softball with him when he hit one, and you know, all of those of you that played ball with him, you know how he could hit a softball. And when he was out in left field, you know how he could throw out a runner in home plate. But the thing that I'd like to say is, when you mention it to him, he would say, yeah, whatever. You know, there was something about the humility in his great accomplishments that always spoke very loud to me. His attitude about his accomplishments showed humility. Sometimes he was a man of not many words, but his actions spoke loudly and showed compassion. That's what I found in knowing Dean. Fishing and playing softball were always better when Dean was alone. Always. Always. I asked my family if there was anything that stood out, and Dean did some things in large scale. My son Michael said he went hunting with him once, I think it was most of the day, and the way home they stopped at a Pizza Hut, and Dean ordered a large pizza. Then he looked at Michael and said, "What are you going to eat?" So Michael ordered one too, and they ate it. Everything. Didn't make a big fuss out of it. Family gatherings will never be the same. And you know, Dean was kind of quiet, but once he got started, he was one of the most interesting and entertaining storytellers. Everyone listened when he told a story. And we will miss these. We will miss those. I'd like to add that show your appreciation to your friends while they are still living. Do you know, when you see a friend, as long as I've known Dean, I was there when he passed away, when you see him take his last breath, you realize how short life is. And the choices that we make in our short life actually determine our destiny. But it really does something to you to be there and watch someone as close as Dean to pass away. Things have changed and everything will be somewhat different. Many things have changed in my life. I'd like to challenge each one of us. Let these changes make us a better person. I think that's what Dean would want. Let's become more compassionate. And let's be an encouragement to people that we meet. One more thing. Don't wait till people lie in the coffin to show your appreciation and your kindness.
Where does one begin in such a time as this? Here are a few of my thoughts. I will begin by saying that God is still good and God is still faithful. He is still merciful and I still trust him and I still love him. In spite of the deep pain and heartache we are feeling right now, and I know the emptiness in our hearts that goes with loving someone we love so much is real. I know because we have lost my precious daddy, my beautiful sister Rosanna, and now my dear brother Dean. Only God can fill that love-sized hole in our hearts. All this to say that if I believe in the sovereignty of God, and I do, then I must also believe this was my brother's time to start his eternal life. Forever free, forever home with Jesus. Dean leaves his footprints on the hearts of many. I never knew him to have one enemy, and I don't know of anyone he didn't help if they needed something. A man of few words, unless you got him started telling stories about his many adventures. He was for sure my first best friend. We were only a year and a few months apart in age, and I truly always looked up to him. As we grew up together on the farm, we became a team. Wherever he was, I was there by his side. We spent countless hours in the woods catching small critters with a homemade trap he made. We roamed the fields looking for bird nests. We waded through the creek from one end of the farm all the way to the other end. Sometimes we had bloodsuckers stuck to our legs we had to tear off. I remember so well when he started hunting raccoon. I would go with him because I didn't want him to be out in the woods alone. Most of the time, I was way behind him, but as long as I could see his light in the distance, I knew eventually he would wait for me. He loved to trap muskrats, and he would check his traps 3 times a night. Before he went to bed, at midnight, and at 4 in the morning. He did this because sometimes he could catch 3 in one trap in one night. The field in front of the family farm, which is now a big pond, would always flood when it rained. So sometimes in the winter when this happened, the whole field would freeze and we could ice skate. If it happened to be a full moon and the ice was smooth, he would pull out of his pocket a shiny silver watch and throw it as far as he could. I would then run and find it by the light of the moon. It was like finding a big diamond. Then he would throw it again, and we'd do it again. I can still remember the crisp, cold air and how amazing those moments in time were. There are so many moments in time I will cherish forever. I loved him then, and I love him now. I can say this for truth. If you love someone, tell them, because the journey from here to eternity is short, too short. I believe that every moment God had for Dean, for my precious brother Dean, was lived. It wasn't cut short, but fully lived. So moving forward, may we not live in fear of what tomorrow or the next year has in store for us. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, "For God does not give us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and self-control." We don't have to fear because the Father knows all the details of our fragile lives. May we, with faith, move forward knowing and believing the Father knows our pain, and whatever the future holds for each one of us, we don't have to face it alone because the road ahead is already paved with the Father's love. So enjoy the simple pleasures in life. Love others well. Take time to watch the sunrise. Enjoy the rain. Be kind, be generous, and represent Christ well so that the people God places in the garden of your life will be encouraged, inspired, and drawn to Jesus. In Job 12:10 it says, "In his hands is the breath of all mankind." What a confirmation that he is aware of what we are facing. Psalms 139:16 says, "Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were fashioned for me, when as yet there were none of them." That's amazing. Before we were born, God knew the numbers of our days. Be encouraged. God is still good, God is merciful, and God makes no mistakes. And then I want to take the time and this opportunity to thank each one of you who poured out your love on our family the last couple of days. Whatever your part was during this difficult time, we appreciate it. I ask that you, as our friends, would continue to pray for all of us, especially our dear mom. And thank you to all of you who came to share this day with us. And Dean, until we meet again, my heart will hold the memories. You will be forever loved and forever missed.
My name is Sammy Varnum. A lot of people only knew me
I told Sammy I'll read this for him if he wants me to. My name is Sammy Varnum. A lot of people only knew me as Dean's buddy. I was always proud he called me that. He met me in the early 90s because of our mutual desire to raise deer. We also both loved to hunt and be in the great outdoors. They say to seek out people who are smart and have better behavior than you, and you will drift in that direction. Dean was very smart, and his behavior was incredible. I never once heard Dean say anything ugly or vulgar. He was a good and decent man. He was a man of few words. He tried not to show his emotions. Years ago, he asked me to help name his bucks. I said, let's call this one High Roller, and that one Drifter. I said to him, what do you think? He said, whatever. It don't matter. We'll see once. That meant, them are great names. I love it. Thanks. One time I arranged for us to join a friend that was a riverboat pilot. We went out into the ocean, met up with a 950-foot-long ship. We got alongside of it, climbed a rope ladder 38 feet up, stepped on a deck, got on an elevator, and then went up 7.5 stories and entered the wheelhouse. You could see 40 miles in every direction. The ship was carrying 7,000 containers. I looked at Dean and said, what do you think? He said, it's all right. That meant, wow, this is cool. I took Dean on a bear hunt, and he killed a giant. We sat down beside the bear, and Dean reached out and shook my hand and said, thank you. I looked him in the eyes and said, whatever. He knew what that meant. I introduced him to the plastic dental floss toothpicks. He carried one in his mouth or behind his ear from that day on. I guess he drifted in my direction just a little bit. He never told me he loved me. I never told him. We just knew it without ever saying it. So thank you for writing that tribute, Sammy. I believe there's a song, or are there two songs, Clarence? One, two songs that we'll be playing. The first one is connected to Sammy's, and the second one by, I think, Linford requested the second one. So this time we'll play the two songs, and then we'll have the obituary.
Thank you. All my burdens are behind me. I have prayed my final prayer. Don't you cry over my body, 'cause that ain't me lying there. No, I am standing on the mountain. I can hear the angels' song. I am reaching over Jordan.
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. There's a wound here in my heart where something's missing, and they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased, and knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, they won't be to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, scars in heaven, yeah, are on the hands that hold you now. Not a day goes by that I don't see you. You live on in all the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, but all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, and even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven on the hands that hold you now.
This time I'd like to read the obituary. Dean Allen Borntrager, 62, of Millersburg, Ohio, died unexpectedly of natural causes on Tuesday, November 23rd, 2021. He was born on May the 3rd, 1959, to Daniel J. and Esther Miller Borntrager. Dean was single and enjoyed raising white-tailed deer. He spent many hours hunting, trapping, and fishing. He loved to be in the great outdoors and was at home in nature. Dean was a natural storyteller and regaled his nieces and nephews with his many escapades. He was a member of Gospel Haven Mennonite Church in Benton, Ohio. He is survived by his mother, Esther Miller Borntrager, and by his siblings, Karen Lou Miller of Walnut Creek, Becky Joe Yoder of Kidron, Bruce Laura Borntrager of Winesburg, Miriam Marvin Wengard of Walnut Creek, Martha Linford Glick of Cannon City, Colorado, and Anne Elizabeth Josiah Schrock of Sugar Creek. His brother-in-law David, special friend Wilma Miller Yoder of Winesburg, and 33 nieces and nephews. He was preceded in death by his father, Daniel J. Borntrager, and his sister, Rosanna Yoder. Family wishes to thank everyone for all you did for Dean and for your invaluable support and kindness shown to us during this time of loss and sorrow. May God bless you for your love and care. Just a few announcements here. Everyone is invited to stay for the meal following the final viewing here and burial. Those of you who are not planning to go to the graveside ceremony and service can, after the viewing, go directly down the hallway into the gym for the meal if you choose to stay here. After you file past the coffin here, we're asking you to exit the sanctuary, and then we'll be closing the curtain here in order for the family to have privacy for the final viewing. The burial is just outside and to the back of the cemetery. We'll be exiting the doors to the left, and so everyone is welcome to come out there and be at the graveside committal. Jerry Miller, a close neighbor friend, deacon in the New Order Church, will be leading out in the graveside committal. He'll be stopping in the back then before we leave, give you time to use the restroom and get your coats before we exit. So let's just pause and pray. And after prayer, I'll turn the time over to Merle Beachy for giving us direction for the final viewing. So let's bow our heads and pray. Father in heaven, we come to the end of this part of our service, a memorial service here, and we give you thanks and we honor you, first of all, for the God that you are, for providing a way for salvation, and also for your Holy Spirit that ministers to us during a time like this and gives us the lively hope. And thank you for surrounding us with your love and peace that we can have in our hearts. Thank you for neighbors and friends and family members and church that surround us and just lift us during a time like this. I pray a special blessing now upon the family as they, as we pay our last respects to our dear brother Dean. We just ask that you would undergird everyone through the final viewing here and also the graveside committal. We pray this in Jesus' name. We also just pray now for the food that's prepared for everyone. We ask that you would bless those who prepared the meal and also bless it to our bodies. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.